pleasure to be here today. Thank you very much for having us, and we'd like to thank the Ramsey family for making it possible for us to be here today. We'd also like to thank Diane and Doug and Gwen for the invitation, and we are particularly indebted to Corey, who has gone above and beyond the call of duty to make sure that we have a fabulous visit here. Corey, your time and effort on our behalf is greatly appreciated. Thank you.
I'll extend my thank you as well. I suspect everybody in the audience is aware that you have three of the most outstanding leisure scholars in our field in terms of Diane Samdel, Doug Kleber, and Corey Johnson. So it really is an honor and a privilege for us both to be here today and to address you with our talk. As you can tell from the title, or perhaps maybe not, we did try to be a bit provocative with our title. And I should note, just in case you're expecting something different, that we're using it in an altogether different way than it's used in common usage in today's popular culture. So if you're thinking we're talking about friends who get certain benefits, then you've come to the wrong presentation. But anyway, I wondered if it was the title that actually drew people here, or perhaps just the fact that first year and senior classes were expected to be here. So anyway, irrespective of why you're here, thank you for being here today. Today we're going to start off talking about our individual research programs to give you some background about the things that we do as scholars. In doing so, I just want to mention that this presentation will be really focused on our joint research efforts. We've got a collaborative program that we work on together. And so there are things that we do that are very separate from the things we'll talk about today. If anybody has any questions or is familiar with that work and would like to ask us about those things, you're welcome to do so at the end of our presentation. But for today's presentation, we'll stick to that joint program. In doing so, we're going to focus on a model that shows the social process of friendship and and the inclusion of social capital and its implications for advancing health and well-being. As we walk through that model, we're going to illustrate it with a variety of projects that we've been involved in. So hopefully that gives you some sense of how the model works. We'll end off with considerations for future research, and then we'll open it up to comments and questions.
So we'll begin by looking at our individual journeys. As Corey mentioned, utilizing a feminist lens, my research explores the personal and political links between women's leisure and women's health, very broadly defined. I am most interested in how women define and conceptualize health for themselves and how they bring that to leisure. My research aims to privilege women's standpoints and create social change and enact social justice by challenging the medical models of scholarship, and included in that are the ways that data are collected and then represented. If you look at my research projects, it becomes pretty clear that the personal really is political for me. My research journey starts with my master's research in menopause. When I started that degree, when I started my master's degree, my mother was going through menopause and struggling not so much physically, but definitely emotionally. And I was really curious how other women cope with that experience and what roles leisure played in that. So that was the inspiration for that study. After my master's research, I left the field and worked in healthcare for about 3 years. And during that time, my sister was struggling with infertility. And when I returned to pursue a PhD, I decided to explore how other women feel when they encounter this health experience and what they do in order to not only cope with that experience, but how it impacts them and sense of identity that goes along with that. Next, I moved on to study dragging boat racing for breast cancer survivors, and this study was inspired by my mother-in-law, who was dying of cancer at the time, and I was curious how other women not only survive cancer experiences, but how they thrive, and dragging boat racing really stood out for me as a group of very powerful women who took on that experience and really tried to change their life course through dragging boat racing. I'm currently involved in a local study with our roller derby team. And in that study, I'm really interested in the ways that gender is reproduced, but also resisted through sport. But throughout all of these research projects, there's a common theme that emerges around women's social networks, their friendship networks, and how that helps them cope with their health experiences, as well as the gendered nature of women's health experiences.
As for me, my research is really focused on the intersection between, leisure experience and the building of community. I didn't always have that focus for my research. Perhaps interestingly enough, I started out in the area of park and recreation administration, and I was very interested in alternative forms of service delivery, including privatizing leisure services in the public sector. As I explored that topic, I came to understand that there was perhaps an issue that that people faced through privatization with the recipients of services being treated more like consumers or clients or customers as opposed to citizens. So there was some sense that citizens have certain rights, and perhaps those rights aren't honored as much if the model of service delivery changes. In exploring that issue, that's where I started to transition into more of a focus on community and community building. Citizenship became a very important topic to my line of research. I started to focus on not so much the rights of citizenship, but the responsibilities associated with being a citizen in a community. And so that led me to focusing on building community, ways that we engage communities in the planning process. And in looking at those sorts of subject areas, I really started to shift my research over to the area of social capital. Now, for those who don't know what social capital is, using the metaphor, I'll describe it as an investment in social relationships is intended to lead to some form of return. So when we meet other people and we start to invest in that friendship, the expectation is that that friendship will lead to certain benefits at some later stage, if not immediately. And so that idea of social capital was really central to the things that I've done, particularly in the area of advancing citizenship or community. You know, as a community, it's important that we invest in each other and that we're there to help each other in times of need. And so that has been a major emphasis of my research. And it's led me to do research projects on such things as community gardens. First String, a neighborhood team, was a specific example of grassroots organizing in a primarily African-American neighborhood in Illinois that started up its own Little League baseball team because the community Little League didn't meet the needs of that community. And more currently, I've been working with African-Canadian youth, and in particular newcomers or immigrants to the area, and how we can work with them to build a more welcoming community.
So as two academics who live in the same household, we often find ourselves talking about our research, and we often do so over our kitchen table. Here we are last weekend talking about some research project. I was hoping Troy might brush his hair before we took this picture, given that we were going to use it for today. But anyway, moving on, here we are talking about our research. And it was during our conversations about my infertility research that we began to appreciate the intersections of our respective research programs. And it was in that moment that we crafted the model that we're going to discuss today. And that model led to a number of subsequent collaborative research projects, and those projects form the basis of today's presentation.
Before we get into the projects that we'll be discussing, I do want to give you some background about the model that we'll be going through in today's presentation. It works like this. The idea here is that we start off, any friendship starts off based on a shared social identity, whatever that might be. I'll use the example of freshmen at university. When you come to university, you're probably scared, a bit anxious about building friendships. You show up, say, at your residence hall, you meet other people, and it's because you have some connection to maybe a program of study, or because you're from the same area that you've moved from, that it's the start of a basis for a friendship. Friendship isn't necessarily there, but it's the start of one. So shared social identity is really crucial, and we've certainly determined that in our own research. At that point, in terms of becoming friends, it's important that people enter into what we'll call, in an academic sense, the sphere of sociability. Now, as leisure researchers, from our perspective, We believe that friendships are truly developed within the context of leisure experiences. And by that, we mean that it's during those times that we open ourselves up to actually creating a friendship, building a friendship, maintaining it, and sustaining it. We'll get into more detail about what we mean by that in a few moments. The next part of the model I just want to make clear is one of the tensions that we have, Diana and I have, in terms of building this conceptual model. You'll note that it says byproducts. One of the byproducts of friendships is the idea of social capital. Before I get into social capital, or perhaps what I'll do is I'll get back to social capital examples of it. So, if we do build up a friendship, then the idea here is that we would establish norms of reciprocity. Back to the freshmen. So you meet people in residence, you start to get together, you go to football games, you hang out at different bars, obviously drinking non-alcoholic beverages. And then as you get to know each other, you build those relationships. And one of the byproducts of that relationship is that if you need a favor from your friend, you can always call on that friend for it. And you presumably that friend will be there for you. You've built up this capital. You've invested in the relationship, and presumably you've built up this capital that you can access at a later date. And so in that relationship, presumably, there's a norm of reciprocity. In other words, there'll be moments where you give to your friend, and there'll be moments where that friend gives back to you. There's also a sense of obligation. If your friend says, hey, I'm going to the football game, I'm going by myself, I really need somebody to go with me, in all likelihood, because you're friends, you might feel compelled to go with that person or obligated. There's also social sanctions that take place. So in other words, if you start to work against the norms that exist within that relationship, if you start acting differently from what your friends expect, then there's the possibility that you're going to be turfed out of that friendship or that friendship group. Now, the thing I wanted to get back to is the idea of, is that a byproduct of a friendship or is that the basis of a friendship? Now, from my perspective, I would say that friends aren't friends unless you have access to this social capital. From Diane's perspective, fairly enough, she feels like by calling it a product of friendship, that devalues the friendship. It's as if we enter into these friendships specifically for these benefits. I would say that's true. She feels like that's devaluing the friendship. So therefore, we came together and it says byproducts. You can tell who's leading this partnership here. So so the idea is if you build up this social capital, then it can facilitate certain actions. And by certain actions, we're referring to expressive action or getting by. In other words, emotional support. So those times where you get a really bad grade on a term paper, your friend's there to console you, to help you get by. There's also, it facilitates instrumental action. In other words, it helps you get ahead. So if you need a lift to go home over the weekend and your friend happens to be going that way, that friend will give you that ride to wherever you need to go. It helps you get ahead. We've also identified something that we call obstructive action. There are times where perhaps through peer pressure, we get involved in certain activities or do certain things that actually ultimately do harm to ourselves. Peer pressure, as you know, could be examples of drinking, illicit drug use, or whatever it might be that perhaps isn't quite positive for your everyday health and well-being. And so that can lead to this idea of obstructive action. The idea here is that this is the social process that we believe happens in terms of friendships. Based on this experience, you may decide to exit the partnership, maybe, or the friendship, so maybe you're not getting what you need from the friendship, or you remain loyal and you continue to build and maintain and sustain that friendship. We're going to talk about this in more detail, but before we do, we're going to give you an overview of the selected studies from our joint research program where we'll use certain illustrations.
So the first study we're going to talk about today is based on my dissertation research, which we mentioned earlier, which was a feminist analysis of women's experiences with infertility. So for this study, I conducted 32 interviews with women who had encountered infertility and reached some sort of closure to their experience, be it a conception, a decision to remain child-free, an adoption, or seeking other ways to bring children into their lives. And the purpose of this study was to explore women's lived experience with infertility in a pronatalist society. And that's a society where, despite broadening social roles for both men and women, women are still primarily valued for their ability to conceive biological children. And I had a particular focus on the roles of leisure and implications for conceptualizations of family. Some of the conceptual issues that I explored during this study included the constraining impact of infertility on women's lives, but also the opportunities it afforded them for personal growth and empowerment, the value of social support in helping women cope with infertility, and connecting with others in a similar situation. So as I mentioned earlier, this was the study that really got us thinking about our mutual research interests, and in particular, the role of women's friendship networks in coping with experiences. The second study that we're going to talk about today is what we refer to as our playgroup politics study. This was a research project we did with women who were involved in grassroots playgroups, so not the ones that were structured through health organizations or through the YMCA, but playgroups that had sort of emerged in neighborhoods that women had started up themselves. In this study, we wanted to look at the costs and benefits of memberships in playgrooms for women's health and well-being while raising young children. Some of the conceptual issues that we looked at included the role that gender plays in accessing resources through social ties. The feminist literature has pointed out that women tend to be at a disadvantage when accessing resources, so we wanted to look more specifically at that. We also wanted to look at support and solidarity. And in this study, we wanted to look at exclusionary practices. And it was those practices that led us to strongly consider the role of obstructive action in our model. The third study is one that we did with Gilda's Club of Greater Toronto. And this is a club for people living with cancer, both family, friends, and people themselves who have cancer. And in this study, we looked at the role of place in the development of social capital for the purposes of furthering health and well-being for those living with cancer. Some of the conceptual issues we explored included how survivors craft their quality of life, which we learned was very intentional. We looked at the therapeutic functions of Gilda Club, including recreation. And then we looked at the human dimension of cancer experiences, wanting to recognize that cancer is more than a medical story, it's also a feeling story. And this study really spoke to the role of place and reinforced the importance of shared social identity in our model. And then the fourth study we're going to talk about today is our most recent study, and this looked at momstown.ca, which is an online social networking for moms of young children. And in this study, we sought to explore the roles of social networking sites in the development of social and peer support for moms of young children. And this is a neat organization insofar as they bring people together face-to-face and online. So we wanted to look at social isolation, what causes it, and how online and face-to-face can be help remedy that. We wanted to look at leisure-oriented sociability and then accessing support online. And this study contributed to our online component of understanding interaction in our model, but also that it's not just about shared social identity, but also shared interests. And we're going to talk about that more specifically when we get to the model.
All right, so those four studies that Diana reviewed are the ones that we'll use to illustrate the model as we go through it in more detail. We'll start off by discussing that first step, this idea of friendship based on a shared social identity.
So taken together, what our four studies that we're going to highlight today have shown us is that people really need to get together based on this shared social identity. That it needs to be, there needs to be some reason for people to come together, and most often they want to connect with other people like themselves. So be it an experience with infertility, being a cancer survivor, or a new mother, people need a reason to come together. And this is consistent with the homophilus principle, which assumes that social interactions are more likely to take place among individuals with similar social positions within a social structure. So this goes back to the notion that birds of a feather flock together. Now, some social capital theorists would argue that we need to decide whether this is bridging or whether it's bonding. And what we're trying to purport through our model is that irrespective of the scenario, bridging or bonding, that people really need to come together over this shared social identity. And that's somewhat of a subjective judgment, whether that's bridging or bonding. Now, this is a source of contention with us and some other people who engage in social capital theory. So this might be an interesting point to come back to during the Q&A. But this point was really hammered home for us when we did our studies with moms, because we would say to them, well, why do you need to connect with somebody who's got a child the same age? Why not call up your own mom or an aunt or somebody down the street? And they would say, no, it's not really about motherhood. It's about motherhood with somebody who's in it in this moment with a child who has the same, who is of the same age as my own children. So it really underscored for us the importance of this shared social identity of somebody who's in a similar situation as you are in that moment.
All right, next up, we will focus on this idea of the sphere of sociability. Now, Diana had mentioned that the idea that people come together based on a shared social identity, but the reality is that's not enough. Getting back to that example of freshmen at university, just because other people are also in the same boat doesn't mean that you're necessarily going to get along. You have to build that relationship. And as we would argue that as you engage in leisure experiences together, that's where you start to come together, not just based on identity, but with a shared purpose or a shared interest. And so here we would argue that leisure plays a fundamental role in attracting people to socialize together and encourages them to build meaningful relationships that can lead to the development of durable, should say, friendships. Okay, so it moves from relationship to actual friendship. Now, this is very consistent with the social capital literature, which says that if you're going to build social capital, it is premised upon the idea of sociability, that we need to continually invest in social relationships, otherwise they wither. If you can think about it, as you get to know a friend, if you lose touch with that friend, then it's hard to go back to that friend years and years later and expect that they're going to do the same sorts of favors for you that they might have done in the moment where you were actively investing in that friendship. And so with this in mind, to maintain our stocks of social capital, we must routinely reinvest in our relationships by continuing to be social. Now, in a separate study, we've talked about how leisure, what we call leisure episodes. So even moments at work, quote unquote work by the water cooler or wherever it might be, are crucial to that sort of relationship building or friendship building process. Those are times where, again, we sort of open ourselves up to building the types of friendships that lead to the development of social capital. Now, Diana had mentioned this study at Gilda's Club of Greater Toronto. One of the interesting finds from that research is that Gilda's Club is what we might term a third place. And by that, this is a term that, that the sociologist Ray Oldenburg used to describe not the first place, home, and not the second place, work or school, but rather a third place where community happens. Gilda's Club provide a therapeutic landscape that addressed the emotional loneliness of the participants or the members of the club, not just through companionship and friendship, but more importantly through access to personal and emotional support. So what happened was, as people got together, the initial stage in developing friendships was that this place served as a place to gather. But over time, as people got to know each other, and it became more of a place as home, as Rosenbaum, 2006, would describe it. Now, what we found was that place mattered here. The people who talked about Gilda's Club also talked about engaging in similar social support groups at their hospital. But they viewed those groups very differently because they saw the hospital as being their second place. Besides school or besides home, they had to be at the second place, the hospital, to get their treatments and whatnot. And so they felt it was a very sterile environment. It wasn't the type of environment conducive to building a friendship. This idea of a third place, which has a lot of leisure dimensions to it, in terms of that it's freely and voluntarily participated in or visited, is quite crucial then in terms of building those types of friendships.
So when we delve into the literature, we looked at people like Putnam, who's a strong researcher in this area, and we noticed that the literature really tended to privilege face-to-face interaction. So we were inclined to examine the role that online relationships play in the development of friendship. And we did this for our Momstown study, which is the group that brings people together both face-to-face and online. And when we talked to the women in that study, we found that women felt socially isolated for a whole host of reasons. Sometimes they were new to the community because they had moved around. Many of them were sort of the first in their age group to have children, so they didn't have peers that had kids at the same stage as them. Many were new to staying at home with children. And so they felt socially isolated in a way that previous generations of mothers have not reported. And as a result, these women were desperate to connect with other moms who were in a similar situation to them, so desperate that some of them engaged in what they called stroller stalking, where they would go out and try to connect with anybody else who had a kid in a stroller. Now, what the women found was that stroller stalking was not very effective in terms of making meaningful relationships, because often the women had nothing in common other than the fact that they both had kids in strollers. And as a result, many of the women found themselves on what they termed to be bad mommy dates, where the play date didn't go well, not only because of the kids, but also because the moms had nothing in common. So what we found was that these online interactions facilitated what we call friend shipping or friend shopping, where the women had a chance to go online, look through profiles of other moms, and shop around for friends that they would have similar interests that they could connect over. So they would go online and they would shop for these friends, and that facilitated their face-to-face interactions combined with electronic correspondence. And that type of correspondence enabled them to engage in friend shipping, which is the development of long-term sustainable relationships. And this type of friend shipping led to what we're calling momances, or deep platonic relationships that developed between the women. And these types of relationships had a significant impact on the women's experiences with motherhood, and felt like they really contributed to not only surviving those early days of parenthood, but thriving during those early days of motherhood. And so this speaks to the type of friending, tending and befriending that women tend to do that we found both online and offline and face-to-face.
Okay, so next up we'll talk more about social capital. To give you a very specific definition, the one that Diana and I typically use is one that we devised a few years ago, and that is in this presentation, when we talk about social capital, what we're referring to is the consequence of investment in and cultivation of social relationships, allowing an individual access to resources that would otherwise be unavailable to him or her. So, the idea behind social capital is that we all individually have our own human capital. So we build up different skills and master different things. And that's fantastic, but we can't rely on those things alone to achieve any sort of success or even get by in everyday life. What we inevitably have to do is draw on other people's resources to do things that we want to do. And that means that we need to build up this idea of social capital. We need to invest in our relationships and then draw on that sort of capital that's there based on, you know, the friendship that we've developed. So in terms of forms of social capital, I mentioned them before, but to give you a more specific description of them, in our research we identified in particular these different forms of social capital. First, the idea of obligations and expectations. These, of course, provide incentives for individuals to invest in community networks or their friendship networks and accrue obligations, which investors trust will be reciprocated and repaid upon request by possibly a different network member. So again, the idea is as we build friendships, we expect that we'll do favors for some people, our friends will do favors for us. And when we call on them, they'll be there for us. And sometimes we'll expect that we may do something for somebody, expecting that somebody else may do something for us in the future. It'll be, we'll pay it forward, and somebody else will pay it back someday. We also have found in our research the idea of norms and effective sanctions. These persuade members or friends to work for the collective good of the friendship network or the community network and in its members' interests. And so this is, again, linked to the idea of every friendship network is going to establish norms by which they operate and expect that the friends within that network follow those norms. And in instances where they don't, there are sanctions in terms of being left out of different activities or perhaps even just left out of the friendship altogether. Now, the best way to describe these forms of social capital and what they do is to focus on the types of actions that they facilitate. And so we're going to go through each different type of action next with examples from our research projects. So again, those different actions are expressive action, instrumental action, and obstructive action. Now, just to remind you, expressive action is a fancy way of describing social support. It refers to the emotional support available and through our social connections.
And there was lots of examples of expressive action in all of our studies, two that we'll share with you today, the first one being from our Gilda's Club study. What we found is that the people in Gilda's Club wanted to make what they referred to as cancer friends. So they wanted to make friends with other people who had cancer. They felt like they didn't get that type of friendship at the hospital, and they felt badly burdening their family members with that type of support, because often what they were looking for is to help them through their friendships, work through facing their own mortality, for example. And that's very hard for a family member to hear. So they wanted to work through those issues with other people who could empathize with the way they felt. Now, interestingly, at Gilda's Club, some people went there looking to work through those issues, seeking to cope with their feelings connected with having cancer, but other people went to Gilda's Club looking to leave that identity behind them at the door, to no longer be identified as a cancer patient, but to feel like themselves for a little bit of time. And Gilda's Club did a great job of facilitating both, so that both groups could go there and feel like they got the emotional support they needed. It also, expressive action also stood out in our Momstown study, where we saw women looking to connect with each other, often at times when it's difficult to reach support through family members or other friends. And one of those times is at 2 a.m. when you're up with a child who will not sleep. The benefit of the Momstown connection is that it offered women the opportunity to connect online, and so they felt like there was always somebody there. So one woman in our study told us about trying to sleep train her child, which she had mixed emotions on doing, but she was exhausted and she needed her child to sleep so that she could sleep and be what she considered a better parent because she wasn't so sleep deprived. So she was up at 2 a.m. listening to her child cry and cry and cry, beginning to doubt her decision, and she posted on the Momstown website that she was struggling with this sleep training, and she said instantaneously 7 messages popped up saying, hang in there, thinking of you, hoping that it passes quickly, you know, hang in there. And this type of support really did help the woman feel like she was supported, that she got the help that she needed in that moment and was able to carry through with getting her child to sleep that night.
All right, the second type of action is instrumental. And by this, we could refer to that as getting ahead. And so again, it refers to the material dimension of social connections or friendships, which gives other friends access to resources that help those friends advance their social position.
There were lots of examples of this in my infertility study, where the women would talk about things like sharing medication. So if they were both on the same medication and one person no longer needed it, but she knew somebody else that did, they would pass that medication along. They would share tips about what things worked, what things didn't work. They would talk about doctors, who was good, who wasn't good. They would share alternative treatment remedies, and they would talk about different adoption paths and things like that. So lots of information sharing that really helped the women feel like they were making progress on either seeking some sort of resolution to their experience with infertility. This also popped up in our playgroup study, where the women would talk about sharing clothing for kids, sharing babysitters, sharing daycare resources, seeking a pair of shoes and coming home after posting that and having 5 pairs of shoes on their doorstep. There tends to be a stereotype in the literature that women really seek out expressive action, and what our research has demonstrated that instrumental action is actually vital to women's health and well-being too, that this plays a significant role in making them feel like they're getting ahead and making progress as a parent or in a health experience.
Expressive and instrumental action are very common forms of action. They're identified by many social capital researchers. But the idea of obstructive action has been acknowledged in that literature, but not necessarily been factored in when considering the experience of social capital among friends or community networks. And so we feel that this is a really important thing to consider whenever people examine social capital and people's lived experiences. By obstructive action, we're referring to people falling behind. And so it refers to the actions taken by network members or friends that do themselves harm. So there are instances where we feel obligated to our friends and perhaps worry about the sanctions that our friends may place on us, and therefore do things that perhaps are not in our best to our best interest. And so we've identified this form of action by underscoring the costs that they place on individuals, and its inclusion in this model acknowledges the ill effects friendships can have for individuals.
So this first caught our eye in the infertility study, when there was a group of people who were all going through this experience of infertility together, and then one person became pregnant or one person was able to adopt a child and the other people felt left behind. And so what often happened was, because they were in this group together, the people who felt left behind simultaneously felt obligated to support their friend. So whether that meant shopping for baby clothes very quickly because a child had just been placed with you, or attending a baby shower. So the people who felt left behind were obligated because of their friendship to engage in these pursuits, even though it made them feel badly about their own situation. Not that they were unhappy for their friend, they were often very happy for their friend, but nonetheless felt personally, it just reminded them of where they were along that journey themselves. And so it had implications for their sense of health and well-being, because they were obligated to return expectations around behavior that were based upon their friendship. This also came up quite strongly in our playgroup politics study, where the women would talk about being in these grassroots groups where they often came together around issues connected to parenthood. And in those groups, they would talk about fairly contentious issues, things like whether or not they should circumcise their kids, breastfeeding versus bottle feeding, sleep training versus not letting your child cry it out, making your child sleep in a crib versus co-sleeping. So these types of contentious issues would come up and the women would talk about them. And often people who felt like their opinion differed than those in the dominant group, they felt like they were judged. They were often left out. And there was one woman who said she was literally dropped from her playgroup email list because her opinions differed from the other people in the group. And they often felt it was a context in which they got gendered. So the expectations that they shared around their own behavior, expectations for their partner's behavior, were also very gendered. And so these were instances where we felt demonstrated this notion of obstructive action.
And the idea of getting gendered was quite interesting from this perspective too, because a lot of the women talked about being part of these playgroups, chatting informally with each other as friends do, but feeling some pressure to actually put down their spouse in these conversations. And so there was sort of this gendered expectation that as women, they should put down their male partners, and that made a lot of people feel uncomfortable.
Not
so
me.
Another example. What's that?
I said not me.
We'll address that later.
Or not.
All right, so finally, this is, as I mentioned, toward the end of the model, based on the experience of friendship, this is where people start to revisit their friendships and decide whether they are truly friendships or whether the friendships warrant continued maintenance and sustainability. And so in many cases, based on the experiences, people will remain loyal and will continue to reinvest in those relationships and go through this process, you know, again and again and again. Others, or perhaps over time, it's quite possible that people will choose to exit the friendship, maybe because of those examples of obstructive action, you know, feeling uncomfortable, doing things to support your friend and feeling that I just can't do this anymore, you know, I can't be part of this friendship. And which is kind of interesting too, because, you know, the example of infertility, where people would, where one of the friends may eventually get pregnant, that changes that person's social identity. And so that can have implications for whether they're part of that group or perceived as part of that giving that reason for coming together in the first place. So this is an area that we want to acknowledge we haven't done a lot of research in, and see this as something that, that we need to look into in the future, or for others to look into in the future.
So where are we going to go with this next? Well, one of the things we'd like to look at is shared social identity and interconnectivity. So we're interested in how does interconnectivity impact upon shared social identity? How do differences among women impact upon their ability to come together in this shared social identity? So we want to look at how interconnectivity impacts upon women's tending and befriending.
We have started along the lines of looking at access to social capital. This is the idea that, you know, not everybody brings to their friendships the same resources. So in that sense, often that we would call that a capital deficit, the idea that people bring different things to their friendships. Some people have more things to give to others than others. And so that may have implications in terms of whether they're actually able to access the same amount of resources as their friends. Likewise, there can be a return deficit based on your own social identity or your social position within your friendship network. In other words, if you think of your own friendship networks, you know, there are certain friends who are part of that network who could ask for anything and you're going to be there and do anything for that person. There are other people who, you know, you're not going to do the same amount of things or grant as many favors to those individuals. And so in that sense, there can be a differential in terms of access to social capital, which I think warrants continued investigation.
We're also interested in the gendered implications of this model in co-ed situations. We've only looked at it in situations where it's always been all women, even though in our mom's town that has a dad's group in it, and our play groups, we recruited both men and women, and only women volunteered for our study. We would like to look at the way that this model would play out in a co-ed situation. As I mentioned earlier, the feminist literature has argued that women are at a disadvantage in co-ed situations in terms of accessing resources. So we'd like to look at how that would play out in a co-gender situation and whether or not that offers up possibilities for changing gender dynamics, if we couch that within a politics of hope, or whether or not there are certain constraints there, and if so, what are they? So we'd like to look at how this model would play out in different scenarios.
And then finally, we have an interest in the idea of durability and liminality. By liminality, we're referring, this is a specific question for leisure researchers. Many people would view leisure experiences as being liminal. In other words, they can present people with, they can be sort of a temporary experience where people lose track of time, or perhaps it reduces social barriers in these instances. But in those experiences, sometimes they're short-lived. When we think about summer camp, or we think about programs that people participate in that have, you know, a conclusion after a certain season, these examples bring people together in very short-lived experiences that are quite emotionally powerful, that can create a lot of social capital in the moment. But there's a question about how durable are those relationships? Do they last over time? And so the big knock, interestingly, in the social capital literature against leisure is exactly that. While Putnam, who brought prominence to the idea of social capital, really played up the role of leisure in terms of creating social capital, his critics have often pointed to leisure being an area that they're skeptical about in terms of the development of social capital. Are these truly durable relationships that last over time? And do they really have a long-term impact on building community? So these are the types of questions that we're interested in exploring and would certainly welcome others to explore in the future. What we've done in this presentation is try to give you at least an overview of the types of things that we've been doing over the past several years together. We do see this model as being a work in progress, and actually really welcome opportunities like this where we can present it to an audience and get feedback on it. And I do hope that as you went through the presentation, you could sort of think of yourself going through this process and see whether or not it really resonates with you in terms of the way that friendship development and social capital development works. So we would certainly entertain your questions and comments at this point. Thank you very much.
Question, and it's really about kind of the play groups and the online and the finding mom friends. Were these primarily stay-at-home moms, or were some of them professional as well? Because I see in my own personal experience, there's very different groups in that play groups often meet during the week.
Yeah. That's a great question. It's important to remember that that research was actually conducted in Canada. And in Canada, we have 1 year paid parental leave. And I use the word parental intentionally. Both men and women can take a year paid to stay at home for the first year of their child's life. And so that's why we recruited both men and women for those studies. And unfortunately, we just had women volunteer. So initially, a lot of the people were on parental leave, and so they were at home caring for children. And then for some of the Momstown worked with people who had children under the ages of 6. So many of those people had gone back into the workforce. And so that was a mixed group. They had evening programs, they have weekend programs, and then they have this online component that they found people contributed to often during the workday. So they would pop onto the mom's group and see what was happening at Momstown during their lunch break or getting dinner ready or things like that. So it's a little bit of a different context insofar as that most people do take that 1 year parental leave and so have that time to meet during the week, but the groups were flexible. It's a great question.
I just want to mention too, like what Diana was saying about the online connections. There has been a lot of debate about social networking online and whether it contributes to building social capital. And I think that for the longest time, face-to-face interactions have been privileged as being the most important thing you can do to building friendships, building relationships. But as Diana explained, you know, people who these women who went back to work were still able to, you know, maintain those connections, still connect with other people, find out what was happening, and still get involved. So if anything, it strikes us that you know, the online connections are complementary, if anything, and quite crucial in today's world in terms of staying connected with folks. And I'd be curious what other people think about that too.
Diane, sorry, go ahead.
Yeah. That's an excellent question. That gets back to the comment about how important are online connections and do they really build social capital? So if you look at the model, we could say, well, people come together, you know, because they're interested in gaming, they join World of Warcraft, you know, which we would say would be part of their sphere of sociability. In that, this is the big question. You know, do they build relationships? Do they maintain them? Do they sustain them through their participation? Now, I'm not a gamer, so people can tell me, but I suspect that you do connect with certain people where you start saying, hey, is so-and-so online? Hey, are we going to work together? We went through this battle together, you know, like, and it worked out. This is fantastic. You know, we're online friends. Now, based on that, though, Is there, does this type of thing develop? And again, I don't know enough about the experience to say, but, you know, if you say to your friends, look, we need to get together, like, to take on this battle every day at 4 p.m., there's some sense of obligation that you need to, you need to show up. Now, the question is, if you don't show up, are you left out of that group? Probably. But, you know, again, how some people would trivialize this and say, that's just a game. It's not, it really has no implications for everyday life. But does it? I mean, like, again, for well-being, you could argue that's my source of enjoyment. And, you know, when we are successful in these games, it really makes me feel good. And when I do poorly in those games, you know, people actually show me support, you know? So I don't know. Theoretically, I could sort of see how it would work. I don't know enough about that, but it's an excellent research project and a great graduate project if you're looking for one.
And actually, I'll just add to that. Fern Delamere, who's a Canadian researcher, has looked at the gender politics of gaming, and she has found that there's significant gender differences in the gaming experience that I think would be interesting to study in relationship to this model. So good on you if you want to take it up.
Diane, I think you had a question.
I really enjoyed and appreciate your presentation, and in particular what I like is how you took this model and then applied it back with these four different studies, because the utility or the real test of a model is, does it show you something that you didn't see otherwise, because it's a tool. And in that sense, I think in each case, the model helped me see and understand something that I might have overlooked. I get curious about this idea of social capital. It makes sense in a capitalistic culture that we look at things beyond just financial capital. And so in that sense, it works. But my mind tends to jump right away to the rough edges. You know, where does it start to fall apart, or where is it maybe not as applicable? And I got curious when you put up the word durability. I was already trying to formulate an idea, and I don't think I could even articulate it that effectively. But it seems to me that this is very utilitarian, especially at the exit or loyalty juncture. And I was thinking of situations very gendered, much more likely to be women, but also much more likely to be non-industrialized cultures, where there is a loyalty. You are part of this family. It is dysfunctional, and you are, you know, totally overlooked, but if you are loyal to it. And I think it might be interesting to look at communities in particular where it's not so utilitarian. It's not, where maybe the social capital model doesn't work. It's not just a matter of I'm investing and I'm looking for my return, and if it's not high enough, I leave.
Yeah, no, I think that's an excellent observation and comment. This is where I actually think that the most powerful form of social capital is the group sanctions. And in my view, a lot of us do things not because it's to our benefits, but because we feel pressure to do so. And so I know that it's looking at it a little differently, and I know you're saying, you wouldn't necessarily view it with the lens of social capital, but this is my lens. And so I would say that's where we've really tried to emphasize that piece, because I think for the longest time, our field, not just our field, but most people who focus on social capital have focused on the benefits without appreciating the harm that it can do. And I think from a gendered perspective, the classic example is the old boys network, in terms of job promotion and social mobility. It's this collection of men who won't allow women underneath them to advance through an organization. That's a classic example of social capital, where it benefits the network itself. And I think that's the idea behind, I think our work is really influenced by Pierre Bourdieu's notion of social capital, this idea that it's meant to socially position people. And that's what the value of social capital really is.
And And when you frame it like that, there's a very conservative position of protecting the status quo.
Yes.
That is, those who have capital, whether it be financial or social, set up the world to maintain capital. Mm-hmm. And you had mentioned kind of briefly, you know, kind of a future direction.
Yes.
The inequities around.
Absolutely.
The distribution of social
right.
capital. But,
yeah.
but if it's as beneficial as this portrays, then if you're out of the loop, you're out of the loop.
Well, and you picked up on that important point. I think the important thing to mention, and we didn't really play it up as much here, but we have looked at the idea of access to social capital. You may be part of the same friendship network, but it doesn't mean that you're all getting the same benefits from that network. There are some people whose social position within that network is quite low, and therefore, when they go to other people for help or assistance, those other people aren't necessarily there for them in the same way, if at all, in certain situations. So it's an excellent point. Yeah.
For the obstructive action part of the model, if, let's say, a group of friends, one of them begins partying, for example, and then the whole group kind of tags along, does this then become, it almost becomes a shared social identity of the friend group, that they're going out together, they're partying together. So then when they go through this model, again, with this like new shared social identity that's almost like this deviant leisure,
yeah.
does the new obstructive action become someone stopping this kind of type of leisure? Could a positive type of thing become the obstructive action because it's tearing apart the friend group?
Yeah, that's a fascinating way of looking at it, actually. I think that makes a lot of sense, because the norms that, you know, you're going against the norms of the group, and so that can be obstructive in terms of you retaining your friendship in that group. So I think that's a really good example of how it kind of works counter to where we might see it being beneficial. That's a great point. I think there was here and then Doug. Yep.
Just a question to your future research using liminality. I come from a tourism perspective, and so liminality is really popular in the literature right now. And so I think of it as just in between and in betwixt. And
yes.
Go into a liminal period where they, you know, challenge their identity, or lose an identity, gain identity, and try new things. And so you actually are thinking about it in the sense that they lose their responsibilities, roles, and other things that they've been
Well, it's a good question, and I would say that in social capital literature, there isn't anything on liminality, and that's where I think it does become really an important point for people to pursue in the future, for sure, because there is a question, you know, linked to this durability of relationships. What does it mean? And you know, people who are, you know, a lot of you in the room, I suspect, work in leisure-oriented agencies, and some of you at summer camps and things. You know, summer camp is an excellent example. You know, I can go to summer camp and I can be lost in that sort of culture, in that point in time, and, you know, really have, like, lose my identity as a professor, lose my, you know, social, you know, the social hierarchy can be totally restructured. But then I leave that environment. What happens to those relationships? And, you know, I'd like to think, and I'm a big proponent of summer camp, that people stay in touch and, you know, they continue to maintain those relationships, especially in this day and age with social networking sites and things like that. But, you know, there's a question about what's the implication. So I guess that's a long way of saying nobody, as far as I understand it, has looked at social capital and liminality.
But I think that our findings do speak to that, because if you go back to Denise's earlier point, a lot of the mothers who participated in our Momstown study were in that liminal space for about a year, where they were at home raising kids for a year, and then they returned back into the workforce. And what we found is that the women found many ways to stay connected. So they may have shifted the groups that they went to. So they started going to the events just for moms, not with kids, or they'd go to the weekend events, or they'd log onto the website during their lunch break and things like that. So they found ways to stay connected. So our model does speak to that, but we haven't really analyzed that and written it up, so thanks for the good idea.
Doug?
Yeah, if you could, I'd like to look at your model one more time. I was wondering if you envision kind of testing it empirically. I wonder if, for example, the expressive action might in fact lead back more effectively to the building and maintaining and sustaining the relationship than the instrumental action. Just based on the idea of exchange relationships versus communal relationships, and kind of just speculating a little bit about that. But it also makes me think that I know you've got an age range in some of your studies that is nice, but it does seem to be age biased in the sense of the basis of friendships, because as people get older, they're less connected in ways that are instrumental. They become more attentive to the expressive and communal aspects of a relationship, and really, at least the evidence that I've seen is that that's part of socio-emotional strength is to be more attentive to that which doesn't have to be maintained in a kind of quid pro quo exchange relationship. So. Anyway, I think age would be a nice sort of parameter within which to structure your analysis as well.
Well, we do have, especially in our Gildas Club study, there were a number of older adults that participated in that study. And to your, so I agree, I think it would be neat to look at it by age, but I think we do have greater diversity in our age group than some of the motherhood information would suggest, although we did have quite a large diversity there, because we had people who were having babies in their 20s and people who were having babies in their 40s. So in terms of motherhood, it was pretty diverse. But going back to the expressive versus instrumental, that's a really interesting point. And I think when we looked at the literature, there tended to be a little bit of a stereotype that women in particular tapped into expressive action and valued that more so than, say, instrumental. And I think our research actually demonstrates how much women do value instrumental action. I mean, there was nothing like being desperate for a childcare spot and somebody calling you up and saying, I found a childcare spot, call this number at this time and you can get in. That type of help from others was deeply valued by the women, especially around clothing and the expense of raising children. That type of aid was really valued. And so I think in some ways, that women felt more indebted to others when they received a tangible item than they did necessarily emotional support. So it's an interesting question to look at.
Yeah, it's an excellent point. And the focus on age would be really fascinating because, again, you know, one of the big, perhaps the most common example of instrumental action is the sharing of information. You know, like somebody sharing information that you were unaware of that helps you get ahead in some way. So I'm at a loss. I'm trying to think of my father, who's retired, you know, the types of things that he would do with his friends and stuff. Certainly, you know, what you've said, Doug, really fits with my perception of my father. You know, he likes to go to the neighborhood bar and hang out with a group of people and have a few drinks and yuck it up and that sort of thing. And it's certainly expressive action. But I wonder, you know, like it's simple examples like he had to replace his deck last year, and it was through that network of friends that somebody said, well, actually, I run this apprentice program. You know, you could, for really inexpensive, you could have our program come over and actually build your deck, you know, for like a fraction of the cost it would cost you otherwise. And he said, you know, sign me up. And so it's those sorts of things where I think when we talk about everyday living, those things are crucial and they happen. It's just to what extent, I think, is the big question. And I think it's an excellent point.
Great. Another round of applause.